3? Shall we start?
Yes, please. Yes.
So, buenos dias. Last slide yesterday. And we said that because most of the phenomena are in nanotechnology enabled sensors are occurring on the molecular level, it is obvious that the impact of nanotechnology on sensor technology will be enormous, and this is the case. It is also obvious that nanotechnology enabled sensors introduce significant advantages over conventional sensors because they offer many times greater sensitivity, lower cost, reduced power consumption, and better stability. They are currently developed in many fields, as I said, such as chemical and biosensing, they are major fields, however also in other fields, we'll discuss them in a second. And why? Because there is the opportunity to sense single molecule, biohazards, toxic chemicals, gases and vapors at the very low concentration level, and they also employ process control and diagnostic. Also, people believe that the new generation of nanotechnology-enabled biosensors will revolutionize biotechnology because we will be able to measure concentration of several species, like on the very low level, like hormones. The concentration level is inside our body is in the range of 10 to the minus 10, even picomolar level. Now, different examples, not only chemical sensors, but also and biosensors, but also magnetic sensors made of layered metallic magnetic nano thick sheets, super lattice. In this case, resistivity change is much larger than in natural materials toward the response to magnetic field. Because we have the opportunity to enhance the magnitude of electric field, we can develop more sensitive electrochemical sensors. Of course, optical sensors, this group, it's obvious. DNA chips for decoding DNA more accurately. So there are numerous research directions. Challenges. As usual, at the early stage of development of this area, there are many challenges. And major hurdles must be overcome. The most important is communication between nanowealth and macrowealth is still not established properly. Because they are two different worlds. Reading tiny signals from the nanomaterials, sending the orders to them, are challenging tasks. But I mentioned that we need the new tools, because we are dealing with phenomena occurring on the molecular level. So one of these tools is measuring noise spectra, getting information from the noise spectra. This is a powerful source of information.
Now, because we are dealing with unknown materials,
the possible dangers are also unknown, difficult to predict. We don't know what will happen with our environment. There are many dangers which are unpredictable.
This is not a standard technology. It consists of diverse materials, disciplines and techniques. So, sometimes we have to... I will show you the example of the molecular receptor-based biosensors. We will go through the different stages of design of this sensor, so you will see clearly how complex this design is, how complex this design is, how many problems we have to overcome on the way, how difficult task it is to design such a sensor. So this will be fully understandable during delivering this example. Dangers, of course, dangers. Nanomaterials can cause health danger, environmental hazards. So, but at the same time, some scientists predicted they deliver very visionary view of godlike control of the materials by the opportunity to build self-replicating materials which produce new creation. So one of them is Bill Joy from the Sun Microsystem, who predicted the possibility of self-replicating nanomaterials. But they can pose serious danger to this environment. That's the reason why we have to act very cautiously with the great responsibility. Look, the same story, I don't know if you remember, when polychlorinated biphenyls were introduced after Second World War. Everybody was happy, you know, many opportunities, great chemical, but after a couple of years, people realized that this is very hazardous material, and as a result, is withdrawn from use. The same story with DDT. Again, it was big. People were trumpeting loudly how great material, how great chemical it is. But we found that it's very dangerous for our health. So it could be a similar situation with nanomaterials, very similar situation with certain nanomaterials. We have to be very responsible. Financial risks at this stage, of course, people who want to make money in this business, they are jumping immediately. They are jumping immediately. Yesterday we mentioned the cosmetic industry. Investors are slowly investing money into this business, but there is a great risk for them at this stage, still. Great risk. Because I tell you something, this is not the issue of developing beautiful, high-performance gas, nanomaterial-based gas sensor. You can do this job. You can prove that parameters are excellent. But situation could be like this, that market is not ready to absorb this sensor for many reasons. So what is the result? The investor is losing his money. He's very disappointed, frustrated, and as a result, others are not willing to invest money anymore in this field. So the conclusion is that every new design must be developed in the right time. Right time from the market point of view. And there are several examples like this in Silicon Valley that people are working very hard several years, they develop wonderful product, and this product is not commercialized. It's sitting on the shelf. This statement is a little bit frustrating. Still, most of the nanotechnology-based companies are totally boosted and bankrupt. So, great expectations, great opportunities, but market is not completely ready for this activity. It takes time because they are psychological barriers. Psychological barriers, very difficult to overcome. So final remarks, despite all these drawbacks and fears, we need to have patience and realistic expectations. This is what I'm talking, that many early microtechnology and nanotechnology development and commercialization efforts have failed due to the insufficient volume and long development time. I deliver you, to develop a product takes many years. The road from university lab to the market, sometimes 20 years or longer. I remember my visit at Siemens Laboratories in Munich, and they were very realistic, German mentality. So they were telling me about their developed products, and I was very excited with some designs, but they were telling me it will take next 15 years to put this product on the market. I was a little bit amazed. 15 years, the results are so good, parameters are great, and they still need 15 years, but they know what they are talking about. It works like this. So, final conclusion, whatever is going on, we have to be optimistic. And for people like us, for researchers, is a great time, especially for the young generation, because young generation will spend their whole career in a nanotechnology-driven world. So this is the lot of fun, a lot of work to do. We have to be optimistic. Now about this introductory remarks. We will go to the particular type of sensors. Okay. So we will start to discuss nanomaterial-based gas and vapor sensors, because this is of great interest for these laboratories here. So the outline of my talk will be that after introduction, this particular lecture, after introduction, we will discuss the major nanostructure materials, semiconducting metal oxides, but more deeply than during the plenary talk, polymers, semiconducting metal oxides, composites, carbon nanotubes, and also graphene. And we will discuss different type of transducing platforms, which could be combined with these materials. First, conductometry. As I mentioned, practically, this is the most widely used transducing platform for gas sensing. Practically all commercialized gas sensors based on this platform for many reasons. One reason is that simplicity, ease of fabrication, relatively low power consumption, and the technology is under control. Bulk wave, we already discussed this briefly during the mercury vapor concentration measurement. Bulk wave, quartz crystal microbalance. We discussed that this issue that there is a limit in mass sensitivity, nanogram range, and as a result, we are not able to measure concentration of gases below part per million level. So we need another platform, and the solution is surface acoustic wave, very promising platform. It allows us to work with the much higher resonant frequencies, and as a result, the similar equation for mass sensitivity, that mass sensitivity depends on the square of resonant frequency, and because these frequencies for SAW devices could reach low gigahertz range, so we can get much higher mass sensitivity, and as a result, we are able to measure gases concentration at part per billion level. Now, the next even more promising thin-film bulk acoustic resonators, BAR, Schottky junction. But there are many others. They are not listed here. I will discuss them briefly. I will show you several examples of developed gas sensors based on this marriage between nanomaterial and one of these transducing platforms. And finally, we come to the conclusions and future work. So, definitely a new generation of gas and vapor sensors is being developed currently, employing nanostructured materials. And several materials, you already know from my plenary talk, single semiconducting metal oxides, binary semiconducting metal oxides, conductive polymers, composite materials, polymer semiconducting metal oxides, carbon nanotubes, and graphene are employed. Deposition techniques for thin layer based gas and vapor sensors are, as I already said, well known from microtechnology. RFDC sputtering, thermal evaporation, plasma enhanced chemical vapor deposition, Langmuir-Blodgett, and some very simple but still useful techniques like salt gel spin coating. Also others, pulse laser deposition. Until now, numerous sensors have been developed for oxygen, ozone, nitrogen oxide, carbon monoxide, dioxide, hydrogen, propane and others, and volatile organic compounds, and also other employing different transducers. So, now, this is the basic structure of the gas sensor. Basic structure. So the sensor consists of sensitive film, which interacts with gas media, physical transducer, which converts the chemical signal into electrical signal. And this conversion, as we already know, is called transduction mechanism. And finally, signal processing. Some few blocks or one block, if necessary, because sometimes it's not necessary, like I showed to you with bulk wave device, which has a direct frequency output signal. There is no need for any signal processing. We are happy with the direct frequency output signal. Now, this is very important. Desired transducer requirements. Transducer must be properly designed if we are going to develop reliable gas or vapor sensor. Structure, transducer structure must be mechanically, chemically, and thermally stable in order to give this reliable electrical output signal. Look, three, mechanically, chemically, and thermally. The next, definitely we need homogeneous distribution of temperature. This is very important. Homogeneous distribution of temperature, because if it's not, our results will be not reliable. Sensor reproducibility will be very poor.
To achieve long-term stability, this is about selecting right materials for sensor, for transducer design, right material. So, to achieve long-term stability, the transducers must be fabricated from materials which not react with gas-sensitive layer. Very important issue, because, to be specific, nanostructured semiconducting metal oxides are operating at high temperatures. For instance, tin dioxide could operate up with temperatures up to 600 degrees centigrade. So what does it mean? That diffusion occurs, between sensing layer and transducer. We don't need this diffusion, because it will affect long-term stability. So, selecting the right materials. The same story when transducer contains electrodes. Electrodes material should be properly selected. So we have to use chemically inert electrodes, heater and substrate materials. That's the reason why I said that when we are using electrodes in any type of transducer, like for instance conductometric or surface acoustic wave base or bulk wave, it must be made from the noble material, gold, platinum, in Schottky, palladium, yeah? And at the same time they can play the role of catalytic metal. But I'm always opting for not using silver. The next very important point, adhesion. Electrode adhesion to the substrate must be very good. Very good, but it also affects long-term stability. And if adhesion is poor, immediately we observe some elevated noise level, and signal to noise level suffers. The value of signal to noise level suffers immediately. Adhesion is very important. So, concluding, we have to collaborate, we have to have a good knowledge in material science. We have to select right materials. This is one of the keys to the successful design. Performance, you already know all these parameters. In the previous list, I didn't put power consumption, robustness, and cost. Power consumption is important. It is always desirable, if preferable, if the sensor operates at room temperature, because power consumption is low. When we are dealing with multi-point measurements, we are interested in a low power consumption. Robustness, ease of signal processing. Of course, ease of fabrication. If it is easy to fabricate sensor, it is welcome, because it will affect cost. And cost should be low. Cost should be low, because this is the real world. So they are obvious remarks. Now, we will discuss nanostructured materials, starting from semiconducting metal oxides. When I prepared this slide, there were already about 3,000 references on oxide nanostructure related research. But today, I'm sure that is more than 10,000. More than 10,000, because semiconducting metal oxides are the most widely used
materials, nanostructured materials for gas sensing. And this table is from Professor Wang's paper. As you can, he listed only nanobells for different materials: zinc oxide, gallium oxide, tin oxide, and indium trioxide, and many other. Crystal structure, growth direction, top surface, side surface. As you know, Professor Wang is a material scientist. Now, the fundamental question, they are three most important factors which are influencing the morphology of structure. Morphology of structure. The first one, type of substrate. Type of substrate. When Rajesh get his zinc oxide, yeah, on an ITO glass, it was ITO glass. Pardon?
Glass,
ordinary glass. It was not ITO glass. Okay. He deposited this because he wanted to examine transmission characteristics. He got very nice morphology. Yeah, very beautiful morphology. When you will deposit, when you will use the same synthesis parameters, when you will change the substrate, for instance, for silicon carbide or gallium nitride or silicon, it is very likely that morphology will be different. So, type of substrate is a first factor. The next factor is a deposition temperature, and the next one is deposition time. So, we have a 3 degree of freedoms. 3 degree of freedoms. It is convenient for us to have a 3 degree of freedoms, and why? What do you think? To manipulate the morphology of the developed nanostructured layer. Why we should have the opportunity to tailor, to manipulate the morphology of the thin film, nanostructure thin film. Why? What is the main reason? Why we should change it? What is the reason? Help me.
Different structures have different
applications.
Loudly, because...
Properties may change according to structure.
No, be specific. What's the reason? What is the main reason that we want to change?
Application,
of course, application, yeah. For particular application, they are specific needs. We have to match the morphology to specific application. This is correct, but there is one even more important factor, which is step forward. Adaptation is good, but what else? What else? Look, you deposited your layers. You got some results. But this is the end of the story. This is only first step. What is the next step?
Repeatability and control.
One word, keyword. Keyword. Are you sure that you got the best from this layer? The best? No? Why not?
Because
which job you didn't make?
Sometimes you want to get a particular structure, but not.
Which job? One word. Keyword. Simple word.
Homogeneous condition.
Optimized. Don't complicate your life. Easy.
It is not optimized.
Correct. You did make optimization job, yeah? So when I will have the opportunity to tailor, to manipulate the nanostructure, I can optimize. I can select optimum temperature deposition, optimum deposition time, and sometimes I can select the proper substrate of my transducer, if possible, yeah? Because for instance, in certain transducers, my, let's say, options are limited. For instance, it is obvious that for surface acoustic wave transducers, I have to use piezoelectric substrate. But there are several materials still. I can use quartz, I can use lithium niobate, yeah? I can use lithium tantalate, I can use langasite, and eventually I can use zinc oxide, is also piezoelectric material. So I can optimize the sensor performance. This is the next step, this is the final stage of development, very important. So as a result, I will be able to get the best from my design. That's right? So these three factors are helping me, these three opportunities are helping me to optimize the sensor performance. And here is the example. Look, we deposited nanocrystal molybdenum trioxane thin films on silicon and on piezoelectric substrates, lithium tantalate and lithium niobate. Why? Because with the view of employing them for surface acoustic waves. And this is the effect of substrate. The same conditions for this experiment. It was the same deposition temperature and the same deposition time. And we got completely different results, yeah? The morphology is different. So I can, in this case, for instance, I can optimize the sensitivity because I can manipulate the surface to volume ratio. The selecting of substrate is very important. This is the first. The next, the same material, molybdenum trioxide. This is the effect of deposition time and temperature of grow of nanocrystalline molybdenum trioxide on ITO glass with the view of employing this material for optical sensing, because this is gasochromic material, like tungsten trioxide. So look, I am changing deposition temperature and I am changing deposition time. When I am employing 650 degrees centigrade, 2 hours, to 600, 4 hours, my morphology is slightly different than for 575, 2 hours. It is welcome because it helps me to optimize the sensor performance. Here is the example. When we are coming back to this slide, we can see the distribution of these nanobells is very chaotic. Yes, please.
The third figure, it is well oriented. So
this one?
Yeah, just by controlling the temperature, you got more oriented?
Sometimes. That's what I'm going to say just now. That in general, if you look at these three pictures, the nanobells are distributed in a very random, chaotic manner. That's right. Sometimes I need well-aligned nanobells. Sometimes, for instance, I need zinc oxide nanorods aligned perfectly perpendicularly to the surface. Or, so I have to find out the way how to do this job. And the next slide is about this. So what we have on this slide? Indium trioxide nanobelts on silicon. As you can see, this is looks like a tropical forest. Mm-hmm. Yeah? Tropical forest. Now, in this case, we have to use so-called seed layer. Seed layer, yeah? Seed layer. We have a seed layer deposited on lithium tantalate, 300 degrees centigrade, because this piezoelectric material has a temperature, operational temperature limit. So this seed layer, these crystals are well oriented to the surface. Now, when we grew up indium oxide on this seed layers, we have a nanorods, indium trioxide nanorods, very well aligned, placed perpendicularly to the substrate surface. Similar story with silicon, look. Nanorods on silicon at certain temperature, nanorods on silicon with a seed layer. And look at the cross section. Look at the microcharacterization results. PCM image of these nanorods on the indium oxide seed layer and cross-sectional view. So these nanorods are very well aligned. They are perpendicular to the surface. The same story, we can achieve the same results for zinc oxide in certain conditions. So again, in some cases, we need well-aligned nanostructure morphology. Well-aligned. Sometimes, chaotic is okay. Now, again, let's come back to Professor Wang, who I told you, from Georgia Tech. What he, in his, this is very important paper published a few years ago, but is still valid. What he reported in this paper, he reported that using simple deposition technique, namely thermal evaporation of solid state powders, he could obtain a wide range of different morphologies. Wide range of different morphologies. Nanorings, it's called nanoballs, nanowires, he called this nanopropellers, yeah? Different type of morphologies. There is a richness of morphologies for zinc oxide. Richness of morphologies for zinc oxide. Why zinc oxide is so important? Why zinc oxide is so important? Because, first, ZNO nanostructures are probably the most extensively studied. This is the case. Wang predicted that zinc oxide will be the most extensively studied material. And he was right. He predicted this 9 years ago. It is correct. This material is extremely promising. Why is so promising? First, because of its uniqueness. It exhibits semiconducting and piezoelectric properties. The next, which we already know, this is a material which has diverse structures, much richer configurations than all other known materials, including carbon nanotubes. We can get multitude of different morphologies for this material. And he said 9 years ago that this material is expected to be one of the most important nanomaterials in future research and applications. And he was right. Among different nanomorphologies, Wang predicted that nanobelts and nanowires are the most promising. And again, he was right. And thanks God, what I already said, that he is a material scientist. He has very strong background in physics. And he is not interested at all in applications. Because as you know, I don't know if you agree, the real physicist considers engineers as an inferior class of researchers. Physicists believe that engineers are, you know, turning knobs, reading something from the doing engine. This is something, it is not worth to spend time. That the real science is a physics. So Wang has a similar mentality. He is not interested in applications. And that's good because we approached him some time ago, and looking at his materials, we found enormous potential for his materials. Yeah? And we collaborated with him, and as a result, we published few joint papers. And we are tracking down his progress, because what he is doing is very important. We can use his materials. Yeah? Now we will use your materials, Rakesh. Yeah? Your materials. Good. So, why Zeternal nanobelts and nanowires have been the most intensively investigated for gas sensing applications? Why? Very high surface to volume ratio. The oxide is single crystalline, pure, structurally perfect, geometrically uniform, and mostly free from dislocations. What does it mean? Because all this statement is coming from solid-state physics, yeah? But what does it mean for engineers? What does it mean? How to translate this important futures into engineering futures? What does it mean? If you try to combine, I need the right word. If you are going to translate this purely physical features into the sensor parameters, what does it mean? Help me. Everybody thinks, early morning, you know, difficult task. Huh? When I work in the US, American professor used to say, before 12 o'clock, don't approach me before midday, because my brain is not operating before midday. I am nocturnal animal, he says. I am creative after 6 p.m. After 6 p.m. Early morning is not a good time. Yeah? But let's try. So how to translate these features into the sensor parameters? Which sensor parameters could be affected by this physics? Which one?
Mobility, resistance.
No, mobility and resistance are not sensor parameters. Resistance for conductometric sensor, yes. But let's concentrate on defect-free. Is good news or bad news?
Bad news.
Pan?
Bad news.
bad news.
Bad news? Defect free is bad news?
No, good news.
Rajesh, what sort of heresies you are propagating early morning on Friday? On Friday. This is heresies. You said that defect free is a bad news for the sensor. You need.
The sensor, it is good.
Why?
Because those defects will be for conductometric sensors. You need more defects so that you can have more absorption and surface. And more.
You are talking like a politician in parliament. counting on your sense of humor, Rajesh.
Low noise characteristic.
Correct.
Free from this location.
That's right. It will affect noise. Yeah? So, signal to noise ratio will be better. Yeah? Very important. Now, geometrically uniform, it is important or not from sensor point of view? It is important? Pardon? Because look, we have to find out the link. In one of the previous slides, it was said that we have to find out the link between nano world and macro world. This is our major task. Yeah?
It's geometrically important.
Loudly, please.
Yeah, it's important, geometrically uniformity.
Why?
As you have said, nano belts and nano wires are more suitable for this, the sensors.
This is not a reply to my question, Rajesh. This is not. Thanks God that I memorized his name. Now we can. What do you think, Alejandro, as a physicist?
Yeah, I think that the parameters you can measure from these many structures will be more uniform also. I mean, the spread of these parameters is not so wide.
Yeah,
there should be some distribution.
Look, I will argue, because when you are dealing with the multi-belt in a real thin film, you have thousands of, hundreds of thousands nanobelts. Yeah? Translating this to the macro world, in reality what you are doing, you are integrating. So, final sensing result is based on the integration from all these single nanobelts, that's right?
Yes.
So, let's see why uniformity is important. Why uniformity is important? Because look, let's speculate. Let's assume that I have a thin film and there are 500 non-uniform belts and 500 uniform belts. The macro result, macro sensing parameter, integrates response coming from the interaction of gas molecules with all this single nanobelts.
They are all different. Which nanobelt?
But they are two different classes. But the final result is integrated. So the sensor, let's say when I'm measuring sensitivity, I cannot distinguish in sensitivity which part is from non-uniform, which part is from uniform. So why I would like to have 1,000 uniform nanobelts?
The repetibility of the...
This is good point. This is very good point. It will affect repetibility. Repetibility, correct. But look, the key to the success is because this is not like this, that you are fabricating nanostructure thin film, yeah, doing microcharacterization job, looking at the morphology, is a very nice morphology, homogeneous distribution of certain let's say, nanocrystallites, looks very nice, and you are happy. This is not all. You have to link this to the macro world, to the sensor parameters. How it will affect macro sensor parameters if I will change morphology, if I will change uniformity, if they are defect-free or not defect-free, if they are, let's say, structurally perfect. What is the link between these two worlds? Yeah? What is the link between these two worlds? This is the reason why we spent some time discussing sensor parameters. Now we are trying to find out the link between these two worlds, because they are not, in a sensor business, they are not separated. They have to communicate to each other, that's right? So, understanding the sensor morphology, understanding the physics, we have to have in mind holistic approach, how it will affect numerous sensor parameters. This is my point. Yeah? Because people, university people usually, when they are publishing results, what they are doing? They are depositing, because we are, unfortunately, we are living in the world when government bodies are assessing our performance on the base of number of papers. Of course, we are interested to publish good quality papers in a high impact factor journals. But what we are doing usually? We are obtaining nice morphology, we are delivering new deposition technique, that's right. Doing microcharacterization job, testing towards certain gas, there is a nice dynamic performance, and that's it. That's it. But this is very, very first step. This is the beginning. Beginning of the much more complicated job. Linkage between these two worlds. This is the key to the success. Let's make some coffee break, okay? I'm trying to pass to you the philosophy behind the design. Philosophy behind the design, okay? Thanks.